Lord, we thank you so much for your love for us and for the opportunity to worship you today and for the great time of fellowship and encouragement we've had so far. I just pray that you would continue to open our hearts to your word and help us to hear the message you have for us today. And I pray that you would just give me the strength to do that, to preach, and that you would intervene in our lives today through the Holy Spirit. I pray this in Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Well, this is the beginning of the year, and there are lists that everybody puts out, and you know, there's the top 10 cars of 2014, the top 10 news stories, top 10 music hits. World Magazine, a magazine that I read, has the top stories of the year. Some of the stories they talked about were ISIS, the Islamic State in Syria, and how that took everybody by surprise. There have been some good things, though. In this year, the Supreme Court ruled that Christian organizations are not responsible to pay for abortions. You may not know this, but this year, the National Atheist Association, or whatever, sued in the state of Wisconsin that claiming that the pastor's housing allowance was unconstitutional because it gives pastors an extra tax advantage at the end of the year by letting us take away the money that we spend for our housing from our income. So it reduces pastors' income significantly. Well, the Supreme Court ruled that, the Court of Appeals ruled that it was not a violation because there was no discrimination going on. If the atheists want a housing allowance, they can file for one. That's what the court decided. So that protects the housing allowance of pastors, which is a great thing because the tax burden would be significantly higher for pastors. And believe it or not, pastors don't make a lot of money. The guys on TV do, but it's just the guys on TV. It's not the, you know, the small fries like us. So there have been a lot of interesting things happening this year. We landed a probe on a comet. It's pretty amazing considering the distances that were involved and the technical timing of all that, and I don't know how far away, it was 300 million miles away from the Earth, and it takes some time, so it's not like steering the car where you turn and it turns, it's, 10 minutes, you send a signal, and then it finally gets the signal, and then it does what you're asking it to do. So, one of the things that I wanted to do this year is, January is always a year of talking about stewardship and using the things God gives us well. This year I've taken a little different tack with that, in that I want to focus on four people that Jesus made note of. There are four people primarily that Jesus made note of through the scriptures. And I wanted to look at those people to see how they were using what God had given them in such a way that made Jesus say, hey, look at that. You want to see something impressive, look at that. And this passage, I preached a sermon on this passage. John Watkin keeps track of this. So 5 years ago, I preached on this passage. Is he not here? He's in the back.
In your office.
Nice. Good. He doesn't know that. But this is the story of a Canaanite woman where Jesus met her as he was journeying. Now, I think Grant has some pictures. Do you have some pictures of?
Uh-huh.
Okay, so number one, a mom requests healing for her daughter. It says in Matthew 15, 21-28, then Jesus went out from there and departed to the region of Tyre and Sidon. You got the maps?
Oh, yeah. There we go.
All right. Okay, I'm going to have to go over there and type. All right. So, Jesus was ministering in the Sea of Galilee. This is the Sea of Galilee right here. Right. Capernaum, Bethsaida, Tiberias. And for some unknown reason, he had had a debate with the Pharisees about the disciples not washing their hands before they ate bread. Now, I don't know how you grew up, but I don't remember washing my hands. Did I ever wash my hands? I must have. I survived. So he left there after that, and he went to the region of Tyre and Sidon. This is Tyre, that's Sidon. So he traveled north and west pretty far. And as he went on that journey, he met this woman, okay? And this woman was a Canaanite woman. You can turn the lights back on. So you can go to the next slide, actually. This is Tyre, the city of Tyre. That arch there was there when that woman lived. Isn't that pretty impressive? The arch is still there today. The Romans really know how to build stuff. And then the next slide. This is the sea. Tyre is right next to the sea. So this woman came to Jesus, and she said, "Have mercy on me, O Lord, Son of David. My daughter is severely demon-possessed." So we don't know how this woman knew who Jesus was. I mean, this is quite a distance from Israel. I mean, Galilee, Nazareth, it's far away. But apparently this woman in this setting knew who Jesus was, and she called him Lord, the Son of David. And she came to him with a problem. The problem was that her daughter was severely demon-possessed. Now, there's a lot of different descriptions of people who were demon-possessed in the scriptures. There's the man who lived in the tombs near Gennesaret, where he would break his chains and run around naked, scaring people. And then you had the one where the young boy was compelled to throw himself into the fire and to throw himself into the water trying to kill himself. And then there were instances where it was just a mute. The demon kept the person from being able to talk. So whatever was wrong with this girl, she was severely demon-possessed. So this mom, as we see, is, and you know, it's, can you picture yourself in that situation where you're at the end of your rope with your family? How many of you spent time with family this holiday season? I don't know why they call it holiday season. It should be train wreck season. This family, it can be interesting. It can be very interesting. It can be unpleasant. But this woman's experience was that she was at the end of her rope. She was out of options. But she knew who Jesus was, and so she went to Jesus because she knew Jesus could help her daughter. You know, it's amazing to me that Jesus went all that way, and this is the only thing they talk about in that whole journey. He traveled all that way, and this is the only thing that's talked about. So you can go to the scriptures. So she comes to Jesus, and she says, "Okay, Jesus, I need your help." What do you expect Jesus to do? What does Jesus do? He heals people, right? He you know, there's the guy who spit on the ground and he made some mud and he put the mud in the guy's eyes and he could see again. And then there were people he just touched, and then there were people who just healed because they did what he said they should do, like the lepers were healed on the way as they went to go present themselves. But look what it says in verse 23. It says, "But he answered her not a word." That doesn't sound like the Jesus I know, right? Not the Jesus we read about in the scriptures. So you can just picture this. This woman is begging for her child's life, and Jesus, I don't know if he crossed his arms or what, just stood there and said nothing. Of course, this woman wasn't about to take no for an answer. So she starts calling after him and calling after him. And finally, the disciples, it says, urged him, saying, send her away, for she cries out after us. So, you know, has this ever happened before with the disciples? Let me think. Don't let the children come. Be quiet, Bartimaeus. Jesus is coming. You know, they're constantly telling people to be quiet because Jesus can't be bothered with them. So, but in this instance, it appeared as though that were the case. Why would Jesus do that? Why would Jesus be silent to this woman? Well, if you look at Deuteronomy chapter 7, actually, the relationship that Israel has with Canaan, the Canaanites, goes back all the way to Genesis and with Abraham. When Abraham told his servant, don't get my son a wife from among the Canaanites. Go back to Haran and get a wife from my family there, from my son. But then in Deuteronomy 6, 1 through 7, Moses says, when the Lord your God brings you into the land which you go to possess, and has cast out many nations before you, the Hittites and the Girgashites and the Amorites, the Canaanites and the Perizzites and the Hivites and the Jebusites, seven nations greater and mightier than you, and when the Lord your God delivers them over to you, you shall conquer them and utterly destroy them. You shall make no covenant with them, nor what? Show mercy to them. And there was good reason. They were horrible people. And it goes on to say that you can't give your wives to them to marry or have their sons marry your daughters because give your wives to them, your daughters to them to marry, or have them marry their daughters because they're idolaters and they'll lead you into idolatry. And that's exactly what happened. They did. They led them into idolatry. And the nation of Israel paid terribly for that. But he says, specifically, you shall not give them mercy. What was that woman asking for?
Mercy.
Do you think she knew that the Jews were not allowed to give mercy to Canaanites? I'm sure she did. She lived close enough to Israel to have encountered Jews before. She was worse than the worst of all people. So unfortunately for this Canaanite mom, the odds were stacked against her. Right? But this is Jesus. And Jesus doesn't necessarily follow the rules that we perceive Scripture to be saying. And so he says in verse 24, Jesus talks to her, he denies her request. He says, but he answered and said, I was not sent except to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Okay. At least he's talking to her now, right? So she comes and worships him, saying, Lord, help me. Then he answers and said, it is not good to take the children's bread and throw it to the little dogs, to the puppies. So this woman gets a response from Jesus, what does she do for that? What is her response to Jesus talking to her? She worships him. She worships him. Before anything else has happened, she worships him. Why? Because he loved her enough to talk to her. When his disciples wouldn't do it, when no one else would have done it, Jesus talked to that woman. We were talking about that in our Sunday school class today. Loving the unlovable. This woman was an unlovable person, and Jesus talked to her. And because he loved her, she worshipped him. But his response was to say, sorry, I can't help you. And the thing he says there is that it is not good to take the children's bread and throw it to the little dogs. So basically he called her a dog. Now, I remember junior high school, and I was not a nice person in junior high school, and I might have said that about a girl in junior high school, but it was because I was not a nice person. So Jesus says, no, I can't help you, because it's not right. I've come for the nation of Israel, and it's not right for me to give you what I'm supposed to be giving them. So the mom acknowledges her unworthiness. In verse 27, she says, yes, Lord. What? Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, what? I'm a dog. Okay, I admit it. I'm an idiot. You know, if you're a husband, I'm a jerk. Right? We all do that. We're all not nice people at times. Just say, yes. Yes, Lord. Yet even the little dogs eat the crumbs which fall from their master's table. So Jesus, you know, this appears to be an insult, right? That Jesus is insulting her by calling her a dog and saying that she can't have what she wants because it would take away from the children of Israel. But the mom's response and her willingness, first of all, to humble herself by saying, yes, Lord, yes, I am a dog. I'm unworthy. I admit I'm unworthy of your attention, of your love. But at the same time, Lord, even the little dogs eat the crumbs which fall from their master's table. So the way Jesus said this, it was that if he gave this miracle to this woman, it would somehow take away from the sustenance of the children of Israel, that they would be cheated out of their due. But the woman says, hey, there is so much. You have so much that there's scraps that fall off the table that I'll take that. So she understood the overabundance of the miraculous power of God. That we're not talking about little bits here and there. That Jesus gives out a little bit here and a little bit there, and that's all there is. She understood that Jesus was God, and that God had more than enough to give to everyone in Israel and her. And so Jesus acknowledges her faith and heals her daughter. In verse 28 it says, then Jesus answered and said to her, O woman, great is your faith. Why did he say that? He said that because she understood that the power of God is limitless. It's not limited by, you know, a certain quota for the day. That God only has a certain amount of power for today. And if we overextend that, then we don't get any more for the rest of the day. That's not how it works. God's power is limitless. And she understood that as a Canaanite woman. She understood more than the disciples did. That God had enough. God has enough for all of us.
Amen.
So then Jesus answers and said to her, O woman, great is your faith. Let it be to you as you desire. And her daughter was healed from that very hour. God intervened for that mom and delivered her daughter. So what can we take away from this story about this mom? This interchange with Jesus must be the reason he went there. It's the only thing we read about. So he traveled, I don't know, maybe 100 miles, a couple hundred miles to talk to this woman, to ignore her, and to heal her daughter. What can we learn from this woman that we could apply to ourselves to help us become people of note? You know, I'll be honest with you. I shy away from anything in Christianity which encourages greatness. I personally don't find that to be biblically sound, that we as Christians are not to seek greatness. I mean, John the Baptist, what did he say? For he must increase, and I must decrease. And then Paul, the life I live by faith in the Son of God. That we're supposed to die to ourselves. We're not supposed to be great. But we can be people of note. We can be people where Jesus says, hey, look at that. Look at that person's life. So as we look at the life of this mom, we can learn some important lessons that will help us become a person of note in our families. It doesn't mean your family's going to love you. But from God's perspective, you can be a person of note. In the beginning of the story, we have the woman coming to Jesus. So the first thing I want us to see is to understand that we need to do is that we need to keep our focus on Jesus because he's the one who can help our family. And we all have family problems, right? We do. We have people we don't get along with or people who don't get along with us in conflict, and that's always great. Christmas is a wonderful time to be reminded of all that, right? But if we want to be people of note with our family, stewards, and as we steward our family, we need to keep our eyes on Jesus, because he's the one who can solve our problems. Not Dr. Phil. Not Oprah. Not Maury Povich. Jesus is the one who can help us in our family.
Amen.
To hold on to the hope, hold on to hope, even when family situations or relationships seem hopeless. And I get that from number two. When Jesus wouldn't answer, and his disciples wanted Jesus to send her away, what did she do? She kept calling, so much so that she was annoying the disciples. Now, that wasn't hard to do. I mean, the disciples were easily annoyed with each other. And, I mean, they're just like we are, right? But she didn't give up. She didn't stop calling out just because Jesus didn't answer, just because the disciples told her to go away. She didn't give up. She held hope in a hopeless situation. Why? Because she knew who Jesus was and what he could do. Three. Worship God because he loves you, not because he gives you what you want. You know, that's the thing that we need to understand in this story, is that as this woman is coming to Jesus, Jesus answers her, and what does she do? She worships him because he answered her, not because he healed her daughter. I mean, I'm sure she did that later, but she worshiped him before he answered her request. You know, sometimes God doesn't answer our prayers, yes. If you've been a Christian for any length of time and you've prayed for any kind of difficult thing, you know that there are times when God says no. Or wait. And the temptation is for us to get angry with God. God, you're not giving me what I want. You must not love me. Well, that's not the measure of love. The measure of love isn't how much we get for Christmas. Right? At least I hope not, because then my family's got to be really disappointed in how much I love them. It's what I do all year long. What I do when they're sick, when they're, you know, struggling or having issues or conflict or need help with homework or need help doing something or help finding a job or a car or whatever. Yes. It's what I do all year long that shows that I love them, not because I give them $1,000 worth of stuff at Christmas each.
Right.
We need to worship God because he loves us, not because he gives us what we're asking. Four, never sacrifice your family for your image. When that woman, and Jesus called that woman a dog, if somebody called you a dog, would you be happy with that? Would everybody call you an idiot or a dog or whatever? No. And she could have bristled up at Jesus because her image was defamed and so on. And what would she have lost? The healing of her daughter, right? You know, we have that as parents. Don't we? You ever yell at your kid because they embarrassed you by doing something in front of someone else? If you're in the ministry, that's especially difficult because everybody thinks your kids should be better. Because you're the pastor. Your kids should be better. They should do better. They shouldn't throw rocks. They shouldn't say mean things. They shouldn't pull girls' hair. They shouldn't do this or do that. And so we get harsh on our children because they're embarrassing us, and our reputation is tarnished, and we don't want them to in any way make us look bad. But this woman was willing to look bad for her child. So we need to avoid, at all costs, sacrificing our family for our image. And I don't know if it's a man thing or a pastor thing, but we need to realize that that's a temptation for us to do, to sacrifice our family for our image. And then the last thing is never underestimate the power of God. You know, we live a Christian life where God can do amazing things in one place. Right? God, miraculous restorations, healings, families being restored, God answering prayer for health, for a job, for finances, for salvation. We can see God answering prayers here, there, and over there. And then, but this prayer, God doesn't seem to do anything about it. You ever had that? Or just you pray and you pray and you pray, and nothing ever happens there. Well, the problem isn't that God doesn't have the power. It's that God has a plan. And it doesn't coincide with my plan. God has his own plan, and he does according to his will. But that doesn't mean he doesn't have the power to do what I'm asking him to do. It could be that the timing's just not right. So we need to never underestimate the power of God. So I'll go through those again. Keep your focus on Jesus, because he's the one who can help your family. Hold on to hope even when family situations or relationships seem hopeless. Worship God because he loves you, not because he gives you what you want. Never sacrifice your family for your image, and never underestimate the power of God. If we can live like that as Christians, if we could do that in our families, we would be people of note. So, has God spoken to your heart on one of these things? Is there one thing on this list that you really have just, the light has come on, and you realize, oh my goodness, I am not doing things the way God wants me to do. If you can pick one thing, I want you to take that one thing. Now, John put his New Year's resolution on the Facebook this year, and that is that he is not going to make any New Year's resolutions. How are you doing with that, John? Good?
Good.
It's awesome. Wait a minute. No, that's okay. Take that thing and make it your goal this year for your family to be that noteworthy person, to become that noteworthy person. It's not about having the best family. It's not being the best dad. It's being the kind of person Jesus says, hey, look at that. That is something that impresses me. That's what we need to worry about. So this year, this January, we're going to be talking about becoming a person of note, and we can be a person of note in our families. Whether they're a mess, or whether they're miraculous, whatever. God can do amazing things in our lives, and he's going to do if we just follow and obey him. Lord, thank you so much for your love, and that it is your Holy Spirit, Lord, who does the work in our hearts and our lives. Lord, I pray that you would take the feeble words that I've had this morning, and that you would help us to see the truth about what we need to do to be a person of note with our families. Lord, help us to become that notable person in your eyes. No matter what the world says, no matter what the people around us think, Lord, that we're going to be people of note for you. Lord, help us to be people who love our families. Help us to find that thing that you want us to change and to work on it and to change it. And I pray that as we prayed in our Sunday school class, that you would help us all to grow in our faith in the coming year. I pray this in Jesus' name.
Amen.